Oh, mighty nice to praise him. To lift up holy hands.
Like the dew in the morning. Gently rest upon my heart. Like the dew in the morning. Gently rest upon my heart. Come on, sing it.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, he rests upon my heart.
Come on, put those hands together. Wherever you are, come on, give God some praise. Hallelujah. Unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Ladies and gentlemen, fellow Christians and friends, you are tuned to Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship, Virtue Hour of Worship and Communion. We come to you each and every Sunday at 3 o'clock p.m. Central Standard Time via Facebook Live. I am your host, Apostle Dr. Michael Biddy. We are perfecting and empowering people for the kingdom. If you're enjoying this hour of worship experience, why don't you let us know by phoning us at area code 773-924-2790. Our scripture for the evening, the 21st number of the Psalms. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord, and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. And the word of God is already blessed. Let God be glorified, Satan be horrified, and the word be edified. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Oh Lord, we give you praise. Oh Lord, we bless your name. We lift our voices to say thank you. Because of your goodness and your mercy, on this evening we offer you praise. First of all, because you've been good to us, you've been merciful. We thank you for your mercy and grace over our lives, yet when we did not deserve it, but by the death, burial, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus, that you saved us from our sins. So now, Father, we don't beg, we don't grumble, nor do we complain. But we come as humble as we know how. We come with a praise on our lips. We come with a song in our hearts. We come lifting holy hands. We come to give you praise. We praise you because you are God and God alone. Because you are slow to anger. Because you are quick to mercy, because you allowed our golden moments to roll on a little while longer. So we extol you and adore you. If we had 10,000 tongues, we wouldn't be able to praise your name enough, Master, because you've been so good to us. Because you're Jehovah Jireh, and Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Rapha, and Jehovah Elohim, because you're the first, because you're the last, the beginning and the ending. because you are the great I am, and because you my friend. We praise you, we magnify you, we glorify you, we lift you up, Father. Now, Father, look on us this evening. Allow your spirit to rain on us this evening. Let some drop fall right now, Father. We need you right now. We need a healing in the land. Father, we pray for you to set free, heal, and deliver. And that you would give us a word for these your people, Master. And then, Master, we thank you for giving us another first Sunday in the year of 2020. That we might take up the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. For you said as often as we do this, we do show forth your death, burial, and resurrection until we come, till you come again. So, Father, we know that our best, that we are not worthy. But we know that you said to John the Baptist, suffer to be so. So we thank you, Master. Even though we don't deserve it, that you allowed your Son to die and give his life for a ransom for our sin. Now, Father, take us and hide us behind the altar in yonder's glory. Any way you bless us, we'll be satisfied. Now, Father, look on somebody right now. We got some sick, shut in, bereaved, confused in mind. Somebody don't know which way to go. Somebody just need a touch from you right now. I know you're able. I know you're able right now. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, heal right now. By your power, by your might, set the captive free. Bind up broken hearts everywhere. Look in every hospital room, every penal institution, and as far as our voices can be heard. We rebuke Satan on every hand, Father. We bind him up. He don't have no power, Master. He have no power because you got all power. Send it down right now. Send down your power right now, Master. Cover and shield us with the blood of Jesus. Touch somebody right now. We need you right now. Hold us in the hollow of your hand. Bless us, Master. And we know we'll be blessed. Bless us with the blessing we stand in need of. And then look on your servant, Master. Continue to use me. That you be glorified, Master. That you be glorified. Because it's not about us, it's about you, Father. And then, Master, when it's yours to call and ours to answer, give us a home somewhere in your kingdom. In the name of Jesus, we give the power and the glory, and all the people of God did say, amen. We give you praise. Thanks be unto God to give it us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For greater is he that is in me, for he was wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. By his stripes we are healed. Amen. We're so happy to have you to share with us on this evening, another first Sunday in the year 2020. Amen. Yet God has been good to us. In spite of, amen. In spite of, amen. In spite of COVID, in spite of what's going on in the government, regardless of what's going on in the neighborhood, God have been good to us. And if it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? I heard David said, men would have swallowed me up. So I don't know about you. There's no other place that I would rather be than on the Lord's side. I heard him the other day say, for if these hold their peace, he said the rocks would cry out. And I don't know about you, but I don't want no rock to cry out for me, because I've been wrapped up, tied up, tangled up for Jesus, in Jesus, amen. And the world can't do you no harm. Amen. Anybody ask you what's the matter with me, just tell them I'm saved and sanctified and I'm running for my life. Amen. We want to take this time to thank you for tuning in, for allowing us to come into your homes, your place of business, on your jobs, your place of confinement, driving alone in your cars. Amen. Wherever you are kind enough to tune us in at this 3 o'clock hour. Thanks be unto God that gives us the victory. Amen. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So we just excited about the move of God. We excited about another opportunity to minister you to each and every one of you in word. Amen. Amen. For the Bible says, study to show yourself approved, a workman that needed not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Amen. And we got a lesson that if you don't share it, you ought to share it, because we're going to talk about some stuff that's deep. And people that know Apostle Body know that I believe in telling the truth. Amen. But it's in the word. Amen. And the word will work when you utilize the principles. Amen. In it. The word will work for you. Did y'all get that? When you utilize the principles therein. When you utilize the principles of the word. We like to invite your attention. We're going to get right into our lesson. Amen. And we also invite you to be prepared to commune. Whatever bread, whatever wine, that we might partake of the body and blood of Jesus. He said, for often as you do this, you do show forth my death, burial, and resurrection until I come again. So we want you to prepare, amen, at the end of our teaching, amen, to partake of the body and blood of Jesus. You said, well, I don't have no wine. I don't have whatever liquid other than alcohol. We don't want you, amen, but we want you to have, even you can use water, piece of bread, a cookie, and we want to partake with you virtually, because I want to say this, amen, the building is not the church, amen, it's just a building that houses the church. The church is assembly of people. The church is in the heart, amen, of men. All right, go with us to Hebrews 12 and 14. Amen. And you will find there it says, follow peace with all men and holiness, a word we don't hear a lot, without which no man shall see the Lord. We want to ask a question this evening. Why we don't preach holiness or hell anymore? Why don't we preach holiness or hell anymore? That's our question. Somebody need to hear that this evening. You still got time to share it on your Facebook some of our family members on our family pages, they need to. Why is holiness or hell just not important in our lives anymore? Why we don't preach it? The apostolic, beloveds, is to equip the church for the work of the ministry, amen, through divine purpose and destiny. Divine, mean godly, of God. Divine purpose and destiny, amen, amen. We do stuff, but we do things carnally. We need to, as the children of God, to learn how to know the difference between spiritual and carnal. What did God call you? I'm not talking about preachers. When we hear the word call, the first thing we think that somebody, amen, had been called to preach. But there is a lot of callings on your life because there's a lot of gifting in the apostolic, in the fivefold ministry, amen, within the confines of the church ministry. So what did God call you to do? Well, for God hath not called us into what? Uncleanness, but unto holiness. That's one thing we do know. God called us to holiness. It don't make no difference what the government say. It don't make no difference what law is passed. It don't matter what parade somebody want to have. It don't matter what kind of flag somebody want to make. 1 Thessalonians 4:7 say, for God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. So I hope that we understand that so far. Okay, the question, Apostle Body, what is holiness? What is holiness? Holiness, all that is living the Bible way. Amen. So holiness is just a way of life. That's all. It is the Bible way of life. And I know it's not popular today because we've fallen after everything but the Bible in this day and time. Well, hell, we talked about holiness. What is hell? Hell is a prepared place for unprepared people. Y'all didn't get that. A prepared place for people that have not prepared themselves for holiness. In other words, to make it in. Well, why don't we preach holiness or hell as much as we used to? Well, let's look at 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, you could put these verses down if you want to. 2 Timothy 4:3. It says, for the time will come. That's it right there. When they will not endure sound doctrine. We don't have sound doctrine in the church like we want to. People want entertainment. They want dancing, and I love to dance. The Bible says dance. But men, when the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. We're not going to church for sound doctrine. We're going for form, for fashion. We're going for job because we want to get paid. Everybody in the church nowadays want to get paid. It's about us. It's not about him. It's about the preacher. It's about... But the Bible said it's holiness or hell. So the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Folks just don't want to know the truth. Well, the first thing out there holler, don't judge. But let me tell y'all something about that judging. The time will come when we're going to all have to stand before God to be judged of all the deeds done in this body. So they can keep saying, you keep hollering, don't judge. Only God can judge me, and he is. So I say the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. But look at this. But after their own lusts, the stuff they want to do, shall they heap to themselves, having itching ears. Amen. So we just looking for somebody that can tune up good. And I love somebody to tune up. We looking at somebody that could dance good. We looking at a choir, a mass choir, or a praise team that can really bring it. Amen. So Romans the 10th chapter, the 2nd and the 3rd verse, it goes on to explain to us. Paul says, "For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God." A zeal is not holiness. They have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. Let me go ahead. 3rd verse, "For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and gone about to establish their own righteousness." That's what's happening in our churches now. And that's why judgment now is on the house of the Lord and on the church. "Establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God." And a lot of us in the church, we make all kinds of excuses to say, it's all right. You know, this just the new normal. Everything is the new normal now. But I want to let you know something else. Hell is the old normal, and it's still normal. Matthew 25 and 41 says, "Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels." Now, often as we talked about heaven and hell, do you know a lot of people really don't believe in no heaven and no hell? But there is a hell, and just as sure as there is a hell, somebody is going to hell. The Bible says the rich man died, and in hell, he lifted up his eyes. Do I have somebody here? And then look at 2 Timothy 3 and 5. I like to give some Bible, so you all won't say it's bodyology, but it's the Bible. Having a form of godliness, just going to church, wearing the right clothes, saying the right stuff, doing the right dance, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Amen. That don't take nothing but a gift of discernment. You know, Jesus said it, "My sheep know my voice, and a stranger," come on y'all, "he will not follow." Amen. A lot of us follow after crowds, but I want to let you know something. Most of the time, when there's the crowd, there's not the Christ. And when there's the Christ, there's not the crowd. So it's not about being in the crowd. Some of us, we like the limelight. We like the glitter. Amen. We like the pomp and circumstances. But Jesus was humble. Amen. Yes. Okay. All right. I didn't know I was going to get no delivery in the middle of my teaching. Amen. So 2 Timothy 3 and 5. Having a form of godliness, but denying thereof. And the Bible says, from this turn away. You don't have to be hooked on to everybody. Amen. Wherefore, come out. That's it. These are things we don't preach no more. Come out from among them and be ye separate. You can't be with Jesus and be with sin and Satan. In other words, you can't live dirty and die clean. Y'all hear me? You can't live dirty and die clean. So the Bible here says, come out from them, amongst them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Come on, y'all, help me here. And will be a father unto you. Amen. And ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. That's 2 Corinthians 6, 17 and 18. My brothers and my sisters, we must manage our own minds to help us live according to the word of God. Amen. You got to do it. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 10 and 5 that casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalt itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Amen. I stopped to let somebody know this evening that it's either holiness or it's hell. Don't let pastors and preachers, or should I say, don't let false pastors and preachers seduce you. Again, study to show yourself approved. You got your Bible, so you know what's right. You know what's wrong. You will be burning in hell with them if you don't come out from amongst them and into the true gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. It is so amazing how people who claim to love God and claim to profess to be filled with the Holy Ghost, just because they can speak in tongues and because they have some spiritual gifts, but they literally despise holiness. They literally despise the heart of God and who God is, and God is holy. Holiness without, amen, no man shall see the Lord. I don't care what church you go to. I don't care how much tithes you pay. Holiness without, no man shall see the Lord. In other words, you and your favorite gospel artist, you and your favorite preacher or woman of God, or your favorite pastor, y'all will be in hell together if you all don't have a heart of obedience to the holiness of God through Christ Jesus. Amen. Well, let's talk about gifts and talents. There's a lot of, you know, especially in the black church. I know a lot of the other folk got, but we got talent. And, you know, we get hung up in the church over who can sing or who can play an organ or who can play an instrument or a drum. And all that is good. But gifts and talents aren't important in the kingdom of God. And when you value talent more than you value holiness, and some churches pay the musicians more than they give the pastor. Amen. It just proves that you really don't know God at all. Look at Romans 11 and 29. As we hurry along, it says, "For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance." Y'all hear that? The gifts and calling of God are without. God bless you with a gift just because you fall away from him, just because you backslide, just because you turn to the world. God don't take your gift back. God ain't no Indian giver. So the scripture there says, for the gifts and calling of God, sure you were called, but you a backslider now. You a gifted backslider. And we got a lot of gifted folks that can sing the horns of, but their gifts are without repentance. And there will be a lot of surprise guests in hell. Why? Jesus said in Matthew 7 and 21, "Not everyone that said unto me," and y'all know this, "Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven." A lot of preachers are not going to be there. And I want to serve notice on you all. Don't you all think that this COVID-19, that God, it's not a period of time when God is judging his people, because that's what's going on. And a lot of us don't want to believe that. It's man-made. Yeah, it might be man-made. But this is a period of time when God is judging his church. Amen. So, not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father. That's what Jesus said, which is in heaven. 22nd verse said, many will say in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in the name have we not cast out devils? And in thy name done many wonderful works? And then verse 23, and then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Amen. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. All right. But somebody said, what about grace? What about grace? Well, what exactly is meant by holiness? What is meant by hell? We fully accept the fact, beloveds, that we should be holy. Why? Because God said, be ye holy as I am holy. But we struggle with constantly feeling like we have to earn God's love, or that every time we sin, amen, God's love for us and our salvation are now questionable. Amen. Or that if we are not perfect and making perfect choices every single day, every single moment, it's only a matter of time before God's wrath will meet us. Amen. It's been really hard for us to reconcile. Amen. When the word says we are saved, now listen to this, we are saved by faith through grace and not works. And then the Bible reads messages that say holiness or hell. Amen. So that confuses some people. Real grace creates holiness. Amen. That's what that I'm saying is because a lot of people use grace and mercy for a crutch to do wrong. Grace and mercy. Well, I'm saved by the grace of God, so I can keep on sinning. Well, the following scriptures apply to this. Hebrews 12 and 14. It says that follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. If you're not living under holiness, it don't make no difference how big a funeral you had. Maybe your mother is not in heaven. Maybe Uncle Bob is not in heaven. Holiness without no man, no one will see the Lord. Matthew 7 and 23. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Amen. There's two sides to the church. It's not all about your pie, how you going to be blessed. And I see you getting this. And you're going to get this amount of money. God wants us to live holy. He wants us to be accountable. Jesus said this to people that called him Lord and did miracles in his name. Grace, watch this carefully, is the antidote for iniquity. Grace is the antidote for iniquity, but it's not an excuse for iniquity. Grace is an antidote, but not an excuse. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Romans 6 and 1. Paul questions, just because we say by grace, are we just going to take advantage of grace and continue to sin? What then? Shall we continue in sin because we are not under the law, but we're under grace? God forbid, because we under grace, God has given us another chance, but that don't mean we should continue in sin. Romans 6 and 15. We don't have to be perfect, but we do need to know that we are saved because the grace of God actually works on our hearts. Amen. Grace is not just unmerited favor. It's more. It's favor and power. Come on, somebody. We know God loves us. That's why he gives us his grace through the death, burial, and resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ, which results, amen, in the power to love him more than sin. The problem comes when we reject grace. See, we reject his grace and we choose sin instead of grace. We say, I'm a sinner saved by grace, but you got to choose grace. You just can't keep sinning. So we choose sin and the things that lead to sin. I ain't going to hell for smoking weed. I ain't going to hell for doing this. The law say that same-sex marriage is okay, but the Bible say it's abomination, which is an unpardonable sin. Well, we going around preaching sin ain't but sin because we want to cover other folks' mess, which are iniquities. When we continually to choose iniquity, it gets worse and worse for us. Again, you can't live dirty and die clean. Grace leads us closer and closer to the God that loves us. Iniquity leads us farther and farther away from the God that loves us. So if we really love God, which do we choose? Holiness or hell? He tells us, beloveds, that we have now died to sin and thus should no longer live and wallow in sin. God's grace is not an open invitation to keep on sinning. I hear some preachers talk about, I thank God for mercy and grace because, you know, I know I'm this, I know. It's time for you to change. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. We don't need to be afraid of hell. We don't need to doubt that God loves us because God so loved the world that he gave. Come on, y'all. But is faced with the choice between holiness and iniquity, and we constantly choose, y'all know we do, iniquity, which leads to sin. We should be afraid of our own choices and the judgment, beloveds, that we reap from our choices. Once you develop the fear, once you become convicted, you'll begin to make rightful decisions, and the grace of God will work mightily in your life. Amen. Iniquity is the invisible virus that leads to sin, the visible disease symptom which leads to death. Y'all get that? Iniquity is the invisible virus that leads to sin, the visible disease symptom which leads to death. But grace is the antidote, come on y'all, that leads to holiness, which leads to life with God. So the issue is to be able to discern the virus, which is iniquity, and stay away from the virus of sin. Jesus' blood is the help plan. It is the Blue Cross, Blue Shield plan that paid for the antidote, paid for grace, and you cash it out by faith. But if you don't cash out what Jesus Christ gave you and you choose to sleep with the enemy and shake hands in agreement with sin-infested folk, you end up with the virus. Amen. You end up with the disease and the death that comes with it. Romans 6 and 23 says what? For the wages, it's in the Bible. Amen. It's in the Bible. And it says, for the wages of sin is death. It didn't just get in the Bible. I didn't write it. It said, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So if you hate the sickness and the symptoms, which is sins, shouldn't you also hate the virus that lead to it, which is purpose, sin, or iniquity? Amen. So many times Christians become fans of iniquity. We like stirring and stuff. Amen. Thinking that we won't catch the virus of iniquity. Thinking that we won't fall into sin. And when the doctor warns us to stay away from iniquity and to wash our hands, y'all know how that goes. And then folks tell you, you too spiritual, you too holy, you're too extreme. It don't take all that. Jesus gave us grace. Then when they do that, they catch the iniquity, they catch the sin and death. Look at Ezekiel 18 and 20. It says, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. Amen. Neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wickedness shall be upon him. So we have to make a choice. So what is an example of iniquity? The original iniquity we find in Ezekiel 28:16. It said, by the multitude of thy mercies, they have filled the midst of thee with violence. Look at the violence we doing in the name of protesting. Amen. I'm just talking about in our neighborhoods, black folks. Violence, and thou hast sinned. Violence is a sin. Therefore, the scripture says, I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God. Whatever you tore up, whatever you stole, the Bible said, be not deceived. Whatever a God is not mocked, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. He said, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. 17 verse said, thy heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness, because you think you so smart. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. Amen. Thou hast defiled even thy sanctuary by the multitude of our iniquities. Messed our churches up. Amen. Got too much going on in the churches. Amen. By the iniquities of thy traffic, therefore will I bring forth a fire. And this COVID-19 is a fire in the midst of thee. And I'm not suggesting that God sent it, but during this period of time, God is judging his church. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. Amen. This is just one example of original iniquity, which we found in Satan, which he passed on to Eve in the garden in the third chapter of Genesis. Iniquity is evidenced by lust and pride. A lot of us, because we're good in merchandising ability, intelligence, we're intelligent folks, we have brightness, we are beautiful, we are talented, we can make good decisions, we are wise. Some of us have the ability to make products and sell them, and we know how to gain success. But the Bible says the lust of the eye and lust of the flesh and the pride of life. Amen. God hates those things. This iniquity caused Satan, you see that? That same stuff that we're doing caused Satan to fall from a place of worshiping God to a place of using wisdom for himself in the disobedience of God. Satan also used it to get, amen, Eve to convince Adam to disobey God. He told Eve that she would be wise in her disobedience, and Eve lusted after the beautiful beauty and the taste of the forbidden fruit. So I'm a cut it off because we have to commune, but I want to say this. The antidote for iniquity is God's grace. That's it. The antidote for your iniquity is the grace of God, favor and power to obey him. God, that's all grace is, the power to obey him, not an excuse for you to continue to sin, which leads you to holiness, separation to God's purposes, away from lust and away from pride, but to obedience and humility and a dependence on God. Amen. Amen. We want to give you the opportunity, amen. We want to give you the opportunity to prepare yourself to commune. Let us prepare ourselves to commune the body, the blood of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Amen. We wanted to give you time to get your bread, get your wine, or whatever substitute that we might commune together. Jesus, on that night in which he was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, He broke it. And he said, this is my body that is for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. As often as you do this, you do show forth my death, burial, and resurrection until I come again. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. The bread. Jesus said, this is my body. Take ye and eat all of it. And the cup. Jesus said, this is my blood of the New Testament. As often as you drink it, you do show forth my death, burial, and resurrection until I come again. Take ye and drink all of it. After the supper, they went out to a mountain of olives. They sung a song. We invite you to fellowship one with the other until we meet again. We invite you to join us on Wednesday at 3 o'clock p.m. for the Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship Hour of Empowerment over Christ Family Network Radio TV. Be my special guest. Amen. We will have real estate broker Whitney Hampton to be our special guest. We're looking for you to tune in. And don't forget, Thursday night, Hope Covenant Kingdom Fellowship Virtue Hour Bible Study with this your humble servant. Again, Apostle Dr. Michael Body via Facebook Live. God bless you. I love you.